In the last lecture, we considered independent joint control, which is an idealization of the real world. With independent joint control, the motor torque has got two components. It has a component due to the motor's inertia and has a component due to the motor's viscous friction. So one is a function of the motor inertia and the motor's acceleration, the motor's viscous friction, and the motor's angular velocity. Now we're going to consider the more realistic case of non-independent joint control, and we've added the so-called rigid body dynamic terms here. What this means is that the torque seen by the motor on joint J is going to be influenced by the acceleration of all of the joints, the velocity of all of the joints, and gravity. Now I've introduced a bit of additional notation here. It's the subscript J, and what that means is the jth row of the corresponding matrix. So this is the jth row of the matrix M, the jth row of the matrix C, or the jth element of the vector G. For example, if I multiply the jth row of the matrix M by the column vector, which is the acceleration of all of the joints, the result will be a scalar. This is a scalar expression because it's about the torque acting on joint J. You'll see that there are two terms here that involve joint acceleration. So what I'm going to do is consider the vector MJ in two components. There is the component associated with joint J, and there's the component associated with all of the other joints, which I've denoted by M bar. I can do a little bit of rearrangement now, and what we have now is an expression for the torque acting on joint J in terms of the motor's own inertia and the component of the inertia matrix associated with this joint, the viscous friction, and then we have all of the other terms at the end, which are the disturbance torque. This term here is the inertia of the motor, which is driving joint J. This is a variable inertia term that we pull out of the manipulator inertia matrix. We have the motor joint friction, which is a function just of the motor driving the joint. And then we have this rather complex disturbance term on the end, which is the acceleration of all of the other joints, the Coriolis and centripetal terms, and the gravity term. I can simplify it even further. I now have a new inertia, I call it J prime, which is a function of the configuration of the robot. It's a function of Q. We have our viscous friction, and we have tau D, which is the disturbance torque, lumped into a single variable. So what are the issues that arise from this? Well, firstly, we have an issue because the inertia experienced by the joint varies with the configuration of the robot. In the last lecture, we tuned our controller so that it had a nice response in terms of settling time and overshoot, but the tuning was a function of the particular values of inertia and viscous friction. Now what we're saying is that the inertia that the joint controller sees is a function of the configuration. It depends on all of the joint angles, and so that means that the response of the control system will depend on the robot's pose. The other big issue is the disturbance torque. That's a torque that's exerted on joint J due to motion of all of the other joints, acceleration and velocity, and also due to gravity. And this may lead to undesirable motion of the joint. It may lead to path following errors, for example. So what can we do about these issues? Well, a really simple technique that's really widely used in robots is to introduce a gearbox. Most robots have a reduction gearbox, so the output shaft rotates factor of G times slower than the input shaft. G is the gear ratio. The reason that this typically happens is that electric motors are capable of running very, very quickly, capable of very, very high rotational velocity, but generally quite low in torque. What a gearbox does is allow us to trade off some of this high angular velocity for motor torque. Torque is actually more useful than speed. We can see here the relationship between torque and velocity on the output side of the gearbox, indicated by the subscript L, L meaning the load side, and torque and velocity on the input side, denoted by the subscript M. If we now address the expression that we had from the previous slide and introduce the gearbox, we see the expression now looks something like this. We can see that the effect of this variable inertia, the inertia that's a function of Q, has now been reduced by a factor of G squared. If I consider the case where I've got a reduction gearbox where G is equal to 50, this is a reduction by 2,500. It's a very, very significant reduction in this configuration-dependent inertia. It means that the motor's own inertia, this term here, will dominate. The inertia will look more constant. We can also see that our disturbance term has been reduced by a factor of G. Again, if I have a reduction ratio of 50, this term here is 50 times less significant than it would be without a gearbox. So a gearbox is useful for many reasons, and it's a really effective way of reducing the effect of disturbance torques and configuration-dependent inertia. A more sophisticated technique to deal with this is to compute this disturbance torque. If we have a dynamic model of our robot and we know the position, velocity, and acceleration of all of the links, then we can compute this disturbance term. So the controller that's shown here is effectively a PD controller. This is the P term, this is the D term, and this is the feed forward term, where we feed forward the disturbance that we can compute. Of course, this means that we need to know accurately the dynamic parameters of our robot arm. The third approach that we can use is called computed torque control. It has some similarities, but also some important differences to the feed-forward control expression. Here we can see a term which is effectively a proportional controller. Here we can see a term which is effectively a derivative controller, and they are multiplied by the inertia matrix. And here we have the centripetal and Coriolis term and the gravity term. What are the pros and cons of these different techniques? A gearbox is cheap and straightforward. Oftentimes we use a gearbox in a robot anyway, so that we can use a cheaper, low-torque motor. Gearboxes do add cost, and they add weight, and they do add some inefficiency, and they make noise. Computed torque control has to be computed every single sample. So if our robot controller is running at, say, 1,000 Hz, then the expression that we had on the previous slide needs to be computed at 1,000 Hz. That involves the computation of those matrices, the M, the C, and the G matrix, and some matrix multiplication. So a lot of computation needs to be done. Once upon a time, this was really, really hard to do. In the early days of robotics, when computers were really slow, it was a very hard thing. So all sorts of approximations were introduced. But today, it's very, very easy to do that at a frequency like 1,000 Hz. The feed-forward control can actually be computed at a slow rate, and that reflects the reality that the dynamic torques don't actually change all that much from one sample time to the next. So the feed-forward control signal can be computed at perhaps 50 Hz or 100 Hz, while the main control is implemented at something like 1,000 Hz. They don't have to be computed at the same rate. For the computed torque control and for the feed-forward control, there is a significant challenge in knowing the actual values of the dynamic parameters of each of the links. For each link, there are 10 dynamic parameters, as we discussed earlier. So for a 6-link industrial robot, that's 60 dynamic parameters need to be identified. You can do it experimentally, or you can perhaps do it from a CAD model of the robot.